Sometimes it takes a different approach to help you unlock your true potential. With Capella University's game-changing FlexPath learning format, you gain relevant skills you can apply to your career right away. Earn your degree from an accredited university and be confident in the quality of your education. Imagine your future differently at capella.edu. Capella University is accredited by the Higher Learning Commission. Learn more at capella.edu/accreditation.
You're listening to a Mint podcast brought to you by HD Smartcast.
Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of Why Not Mint Money. So today we have our guest as Nehal Mota. She is the co-founder of the company Finovate, and she has been successfully helping individuals to have a strong financial plan. With over 20 years of her experience, she is today here to share her thoughts on why one should plan an asset allocation for themselves.
Welcome to Why Not Mint Money, a personal finance podcast where we help you understand basic money concepts and share strategies for you to build your wealth. So let's get started with your money journey.
So hi, Nehal. Hi. Thank you for joining us in this conversation today. So my very first question to you is, what is asset allocation according to you, and why and how should one plan?
Thank you so much, Anil, for inviting me, and thanks to Mint and all the viewers, all the listeners, actually. So what you asked me, that what is asset allocation? So basically, it's an investing strategy where you allocate your saving into different baskets. Say you choose fixed income, equity, real estate, and precious metals like gold, silver, and all. So to summarize, asset allocation is an investing strategy where we allocate our savings into different baskets.
So how should one plan about it? So there are a number of, like, enough of information out there that this is a principle, this is a rule. And is it some general rule that one should follow, or it is personalized to everyone? So if you can just tell more about
So this right now, it's the cricket, you know, fever gripping all of us because of IPL. So if I were to ask you, Anil, cricket, is it a batsman's game, or is it a bowler's game, or is it a team game?
Yeah, it's a team game. We need to have everyone to form a good team.
Right. So generally, it's believed that it's a batsman's game. And while we are forming, say, if you and I are owners of an IPL team, and we have to form a team, right? We will look at it that we should have four good batsmen in our team, four good bowlers. We'll need two all-rounders, and we'll also need a good wicketkeeper, right? So
course,
we will look at really a balanced team to help us win matches. So same way it is when we are investing. We are looking at a portfolio which is balanced and which can help us to consistently earn a good return for a long period of time, and basically help us reach our life goals. Okay, and so how do you go about asset allocation is that depending on your objective. You know, like in cricket, our objective is to win our match. The objective in life is to reach our life goals safely, surely, and swiftly, right? And so we should be, you know, allocating our savings into different baskets. Diversify well that we can handle any kind of ups and downs and still manage to reach our life goals.
So, my second question to you, Nehal, is, can you explain the concept of risk tolerance and how it impacts asset allocation decisions?
Right. So, you know, general rule book is that 100 minus your age. That is like the investment which you can make in risky or growth assets, like equity and all. So if it's a 25-year-old who's just starting his career, and if he just follows this general rule book, that 100 minus 25, 75% he should allocate to equity. But now when I were to look at his life, at 25, his immediate goals is to get married or to buy a car.
Buy a house or something.
Or buy a house, right? Now these are short-term goals which are like 3 years, 2 years away. At this point of time, if he follows that rule book, 100 minus 25, 75, I should be allocating to equity, it won't work because it's his goals are right now short-term. So the best way to decide on asset allocation is to understand what are your life goals and basically understand the time to the goal, whether the goals are short-term, the goals are medium-term, or goals are long-term. And then accordingly, you decide on if it's a short-term goal, then you allocate it to assets which are not very risky, like fixed income. If it's okay. medium-term goals, then you can look at some more debt or hybrid kind of funds. And if it's long-term goals, more than 7 or 8 years, you can really look at, say, equity or a diversified equity portfolio at that time. Now, your question on risk tolerance. Yeah. Okay, it's your ability to handle downside. Okay, and people generally confuse risk, volatility with risk.
Okay,
volatility is that temporary ups and downs which different asset classes have. Whereas, risk tolerance is more about when that downside happens, what amount of downside can you tolerate?
Yeah.
Now, again, this people think that, okay, fine, I'm an aggressive investor and, I will go for 70, 80% equity. And when they just began and in 6 months, there was like a global event and the portfolio is down 40%.
Now, how would they really react at
that point of time? Whether they have that conviction that they'll, you know, invest more money because they are getting that same asset which they expected to do well over a long time cheaper. Now whether they will invest, they will just wait in the sidelines, or they'll actually panic and then start withdrawing. So risk tolerance, you will figure out for yourself, and your advisor will also figure out once you start with this investing journey. Because at the beginning, whatever I think, is my risk profile, when I actually start investing, what is my experience and how I behave, how I respond to volatility in different events and different, asset classes will really help me understand my risk tolerance, and it will also help your advisor understand risk tolerance. Now, someone who's an experienced investor, like if an experienced investor would come to me, I would look at his investing pattern for the last maybe 5-10 years, and I would also look at that, what did that investor do when that dip in COVID March of 2020 happened? What did he do at that point of time, or what did he do when these major drawdowns in markets happened? What decisions he took at that time will help me understand his risk tolerance. But now if it's a new investor, then he should just not really worry. He should bucket his goals into short term, medium term, long term, and he can pick up instruments which match the time horizon and his goals, and he should just start investing in 2-3 years once he will see ups and downs in markets, and how he is reacting and responding to it will help him understand and define his risk tolerance. So I will say that it's not that today my risk tolerance is X, it'll remain the same after 3 years or after 5 years. It will change with changing life events, with my experience in investing, and with a lot of other factors. Now, for someone who's beginning new, the rule book says that 100 minus your age, say if you're 30, 70% you put in equity. But now you're a person who has just started investing in equity. You do not have a safety net. You do not have adequate emergency fund. You've not built substantial financial assets. For you at that point of time, though the rule book says that put more money in equity. But without building that kind of financial stability, if you put in more money in equity and, in case there are volatile times and you cannot handle. So I will say that there are many factors which go into understanding risk tolerance. It's not always permanent. It will change with changing life events. Now, it's generally, said that a person who's 45, he has less number of working years ahead of him than a 30-year-old person. So he should be 100 minus 45. 55% should be equity. But if you ask me in practicality, when I meet a 45-year-old guy, he's already had his house, and he's almost at the edge of like now knocking off his loan. So he's built a good amount of physical asset for himself. The kids are already in higher education, so he's not really having too much to consider for their higher education and all. So now his primary goal is his retirement, which is still 15 years away. Now the rule book would say that his risk tolerance is less because he's 45. But generally now he is not having that kind of financial dependence. He has built a safety net. He has a house. He has a stable income. Now he can take a little more risk and allocate a little more to equity. Okay, so again, like I said, that there is nothing which is cast in stone. It is all depending on many situations. Your financial stability, your income generation, what is the stability of that income going forward, what are the number of dependents which you have. Okay, and again, your experience with different investing class. All this combination really form the risk tolerance, and it'll change with changing life events.
The example was very nice. It explains well what you know, how what should be. It says that it's very personalized.
Yes, exactly.
And my next question to you, Nehal, is what are the key assets, asset classes that investors should consider apart from the equity and debt? You know, what are usually the well-known one?
So definitely, yeah. Like equity and debt is one. The four major asset classes, which we generally, all of us have been investing. Yeah. I would say that two kinds, the assets, the growth asset classes and asset classes where you, you know, you basically, it's more for conservation or preservation of wealth where you are looking at earning a little more than inflation, but not really growth. So equity and real estate are generally asset classes which are growth asset classes, and fixed income or your precious metals like gold, silver and all are asset classes which will help you to just beat inflation, maybe a little above inflation or equal to inflation, but they'll help you control that volatility. Okay, so these are the four broad asset classes which people should consider. Now, these are the four broad, like I'm giving you an example that when I look at an Indian thali, right? You have the macros. So your macros is your carbs, protein, fats. Okay, these are the macros. Now, within that also you have like minerals, vitamins and all. So equity, debt, real estate, gold are like your macros, you know, which we all of us should have.
Must have.
Now, within that, within equity, you will have large cap, mid cap, small cap, international equity. Within debt, you will have like bonds, you will have fixed deposits, PPF, you know, so the broad asset classes, and then within that, sub asset classes. A combination of all this, which is linked to your objectives or your financial goals, time, risk taking ability, will help you create a good diversified portfolio for yourself.
Okay, got it, got it. So how does an asset allocation differ for investors at different life stages, you know? So if you can just help us understand this.
Right. So like I said, that the rule book says that someone who's beginning should have very huge asset you know, allocation to say growth assets or risky assets like equity, because he has a lot of time ahead
enough
of
time
him
ahead.
Enough. Right. But now when I were to look at someone who's beginning his life, he will have goals at the beginning which are short term. Buying a house or getting married or buying a car and all. So in that case, for him, first planning for that short-term goals. And at the beginning, you have limited resources. It's not that you have like a huge amount of resources that, you know, you earn. Then you spend for your needs and wants. And then what is left, you know, you will save. Now that saving kitty will not be very huge because that earning is not huge when you're beginning.
Correct.
And a lot of it will go in your needs and wants. And there'll be very little to save. And that too, you will have a lot of immediate or near-term goals. So how much ever you like to get into equity, but you will have to be looking at fixed income or debt at that point of time to meet your very short-term or near-term goals. Okay, so in this case, I will say that don't go by that rule book that 100 minus this is what is your ideal asset allocation. Look at the life stage which you are in. Like you rightly asked me that with life stage, things will change, right? So in the beginning, you may have a lot of near-term goals. You would have not built a safety net for yourself. You would not even have any physical assets for you. Okay, so in that case, your asset allocation will be very different. Now, when I look at someone who is, say, nearing 60, okay, who's nearing retirement. Now, in this case, you know, generally, he should be having much lesser amount of money allocated to equity and a very high amount to debt. Now, even that 60-year-old person with the increasing life expectancy still has about 20-25 years ahead of him when it comes to retirement. Now, for that person, the asset allocation will be very different. He needs to really be following a bucketing strategy where for the first 5 years of retirement, he sets aside a kitty which is heavy on fixed income.
Right.
And, you know, still have a sizable amount of investments in growth assets because even that person in the next 20-25 years still has to beat inflation. Okay, so I will say that asset allocation definitely changes with life stages. And we call it as personal finance because everyone's personal situation is very different. Their experience in investing is different. Their, I'll say the corpus which they've created created is very different. Their lifestyle is very different.
Yeah.
And basically what they expect from life is also very different. Like some people would want to, plan for philanthropy. Some people would want to leave something for children.
Yeah.
Some people would believe that I've educated my kids and they are on their own. Now, whatever I have, I will be spending it to myself, right?
Yeah.
So with the changing life stage, you will have to look at your asset allocation. You will have to change. So nothing is cast in stone.
Yeah.
And there is no general rule book. Like there is a rule book, but again, you will have to look at your situation, your financial goals, your risk-taking ability, time to goal, what assets you've built, and your experience and expertise in investing in different asset classes.
Right. Got it. So my next question to you, Nihal, is how often should investors review or rebalance their asset allocation? Like it's sometimes what happens. Let's say I've decided to have 50% of equity, 50% of debt. Now markets rallied good. So my equity went up. Is there any general rule that only after a year, although the market has rallied, my equity portion has went up to 60-70%, but what according to me it should be 50-50. Should I just, book my profits on equity right away after it rallied, or should I just wait for a year? How should this work?
So, like you rightly said, that you had begin with a 50 equity, 50 debt kind of an asset allocation. Now, because the market rallied and equity has gone up, and by that virtue, the debt, the balance has changed, right?
Yeah.
Now, in that case, say markets can be in a bull phase for a very long time. So it's just not that because your equity debt balance changed. Definitely, if your expected return on this balanced portfolio was, say, I'll just give a hypothetical number, 12%.
Okay.
Now, if it has really gone one or two standard deviations above what you expected out of your blended portfolio, okay, that is one point where you will start reviewing, okay?
Yeah.
Now, with this, you will also look at the markets.
Yeah.
Now, what is driving the markets? Is the market really very far from long-term averages? Or market is in a rally because earnings have caught up, okay?
Yeah.
And the market doesn't look very expensive.
Yeah.
So, apart from also looking at, how far the portfolio has gone from what your expected return, like how much it has outperformed, and also look at markets. Now, say if you feel that the long-term average of markets was 15%, okay?
Yeah.
And markets have also gone 1, 2, 3 standard deviation above their long-term averages.
Yeah,
okay, now both these factors put together, you feel that now it's the right time for me to rebalance. So you again book out something in equity and move it to debt. Now this is one way to look at it when you started investing a year back and you already have investments and you're trying to balance it between equity to debt. Now the second thing is you were not investing. You are investing every year.
Yeah.
It was not that 1 year which you will invest.
Correct.
Now this year also you will have investments which you thought you will do equity 50, debt 50.
Yeah.
But already equity has
gone up
and the debt is down. So this year's new investment, instead of parking it at equity, you decide that I'll put it in debt. Automatically you are balancing.
Balanced.
Right. So it's not only that reviewing or rebalancing on your current investments, but what would you do with your future savings?
Correct.
After you've considered that, you should take a rebalancing decision considering both these things. Not only your current portfolio, but where your future savings will also go, given that now this balance has changed in the last 12 months.
Right. So my next question to you is, what are some common mistakes or misconceptions that people have about asset allocation?
Okay, I'll say that, generally people feel that returns, they chase returns. If they get like super normal returns, they will create wealth. But if you ask me, in my 20 years of experience, I'll say, what is wealth? If we all learn compound interest, right? Compound interest ka formula, amount is equal to principal into 1 plus R upon 100 raised to the power of N. This is what we learn. Now, when I were to apply it practically, wealth is equal to savings into 1 plus R, which is the return upon 100 raised to N, the number of years you stay invested.
Okay.
So there are three important factors for anybody to create wealth. It is the savings, it is the returns, and it is the number of years you stay invested, or the power of compounding. Now, what happens with a lot of investors is that they excessively focus on R. They chase R and
returns.
They chase that supernormal returns. Okay.
Right.
Now, that kind of returns, Anil, is not sustainable.
Yeah.
What the investors should actually do is just not focus on R.
Returns.
They should focus on S, savings, consistently saving, and every year increasing your saving by 5-10%, stepping up your savings. That's like one very important thing to create wealth. Second is R. If you just get a consistent R, you know, for a long period of time, that will also lead to wealth creation. And again, the last and the most important thing, the number of years that you stay invested in a certain asset class, you know, that will lead to the power of compounding and wealth creation. So the mistake which investors do is just focus excessively on R and chase R, whereas they should, the R, if they have that asset allocation in place, the R will automatically take care of it. What you should focus on is increasing your savings consistently and letting that power of compounding, staying invested for a long time. So, you know, it's just said that it's not about timing the market. It's the time spent in the market, and it's the number of times that you enter the market which is more important. Okay, so that is one mistake which investors do, which they should not really be too concerned with, are but focus on the savings and the time which they are spending. That is one thing. And the second thing which is there is that investors are too caught with the recency bias. Like last 12 months, mid caps, small caps did well, or generally equity did well, gold did well. Now this year they will say, okay, fine, this is where I will invest in. Okay, so they will look at the past returns and what are the recent returns, and then they will take their investing decisions based on that. What investors should base their investing decision is their life goals. Okay, and like I said, bucket their life goals in short term, medium term, long term, and then make an asset allocation which is in sync with their life goals. Got it. Nothing to do with what the past performance is. I will have a like a expected rate of return, which I will look at definitely what the historic returns are. I will understand the volatility, and then I'll make assumptions that what different asset classes can give me, and then depending on my time to the goal, my experience and my risk taking ability, I'll make a asset allocation which is futuristic. Which will really not depend on what happened in the last 12 months or what happened in 2 years, you know. So the investors should not really look at that last 1 year or 2 year returns while making that asset allocation decisions. The asset allocation should definitely be in sync with their life goals and the time to the life goals.
Right. Interesting, Neil. So my next question to you is, see, we've talked about making, creating wealth by staying long term. We talked about protecting wealth by, you know, investing in the right asset, safer, relatively safer assets like fixed income, liquid funds. But, you know, when it comes to paying tax, are there any specific tax efficient strategies for asset allocation? You know, if you could just tell us about that.
Right. Say, for example, someone has a girl child and he wants to build an education corpus for her. Definitely a mutual fund is long term and it's good. So you will do an SIP for the child's you know, education fund. But you would not want to do everything equity. Like we said, that the balance between equity, fixed income and all. Now, when I look at fixed income, the person has that he can also do an FD or a RD recurring for the child's education. But they can also look at, say, a Sukanya Samriddhi, which is a way of investing in, say, fixed income, long term. With that tax benefit, the money which you get is tax free. So while you are taking this asset allocation decisions and you're selecting asset classes, in many instruments you will have this option, that if you understand the goal, the time to the goal, then you can choose instruments which are tax efficient. Like, for example, if someone is planning for retirement, definitely equity is one of the options. But he is a salaried person, and say from the salary, if he is opting for EPF, EPF, again, the employer's contribution and his own contribution, you know, if it's capped within 7.5 lakhs, and say NPS, and if all this money is getting into fixed income. So at retirement, some portion he will need in fixed income. Now that portion, he is planning in a way which is much more tax efficient, because PPF, EPF and all, on maturity, it is tax free. So there is, you know, debt funds now which are taxed at your income tax slab rate, and there are fixed deposits where again the tax is at your income tax slab rate, versus something like this EPF, where it is in debt, but it is still tax efficient. So while you are constructing your portfolio, definitely you should look at things, you know, like the instruments which can really help you basically say, they are more tax efficient. Right. Either they have this benefit of exempt, or if not exempt while you're making an investment, because it is of it is from your post tax paid income, but at maturity or that returns which is accumulating, there is no tax on that.
Do we have any such option in equity as well?
Equity, I'll say that the long-term, tax at 10%. Yeah. It's pretty attractive. I feel that we shouldn't really too much worry about tax because what is our objective of investing at the end of the day? Our objective of investing is to reach the life goals.
Yeah.
It is to get a consistent return over a long period of time and a good risk adjusted returns and post tax. So if post tax, if equity helps you earn a CAGR of 12%, I'm just giving 72 divide by 12.
Yeah.
The multiple is 6, right?
Yeah.
So every 6 years, the money which you've allocated to equity doubles.
Yeah. It
which doubles. Is itself a good return. So we shouldn't really bothered about tax in equity.
Got it. So the next question I have to you, Nihal, is what advice would you give to the investors who are just beginning their investment journey? Someone who's just got their first salary and were looking out to invest, what products or what should they go and buy some good stocks, or should they just start with mutual funds, or what should they do?
So someone who's beginning, I said, don't just follow that age 100 minus age kind of a thing. Once you're beginning, just write down is your financial goal or your objective. What do you want to do in the next 12 months, in the next 3 years, next 5 years? Once you have written down your objectives, it really helps you then to select which asset class to go in.
Yeah.
And like you rightly said, that for someone who's beginning his career, the risk appetite is not very high, because I said that he may have short-term goals. So maybe a mutual fund is a better option to first create a small corpus before dabbling into stocks. Which I don't know how much expertise that person has to read balance sheets or to really study the management and the sectors and all, right?
Yeah.
So when you're beginning, you are focused on your career, which helps you make money. Okay, and which helps you to push your savings. At that point of time, your objective is to focus on your career.
True.
Rather than be worried about the management and the P&L and the markets going up and down. So in that way, at that time, if you hand over your money to expert fund manager manage, it's a better option. So someone who's beginning, probably they can start their investing journey with mutual funds. Simple product to understand, not much active management needed if they choose an index fund. If they are even in an actively managed fund, if it's a good AMC with a good, track record, a good fund manager, I think they free up their time to focus on their career. Okay.
Yeah.
And not really bother too much about really tracking their investments to real time. Okay.
Mm.
So, and once they've built a little financial stability, they've got to their short-term or medium-term goals. They have their house.
Yeah.
They have actually created a small couple of crores kind of a portfolio, and now they can take a little more risk. Okay, that's where they can look at stocks or other options. So someone who's beginning, I'll say that he should begin with a little slightly conservative approach in mind, and first try to create that financial stability for themselves, a regular income for themselves, and the assets which they need the most, like most of us houses like on mine. So get that, and then really start looking at a little more riskier assets.
Right. Riskier assets, as you said. So the next question I have for you is something related to riskier assets. So I think as a human, we have a tendency of always looking out for something new, because good investing is boring. I think so is what most of the people look things at that way. So, how do you see this asset allocation evolving, especially with the new products coming into the picture? Like for retailers, it's crypto, right? And for ultra HNI, that is some alternate investments is emerging, PMS, AIFs. So how do you see, or how much portion of the overall portfolio should these kind of products be part of your portfolio, and how should investors should look at it?
So again, I will say that investors should just ask this fundamental question to themselves.
Yeah.
Why are they investing?
Okay.
Is it for entertainment?
Hmm.
Or are they really investing to reach their life goals?
Okay. Hmm.
Now, if you have that clarity that you are investing to reach your life goals. And say you have a certain income, say, I'll just give an example that 30% or 20% of my income, which I'm saving for my life goals.
Yeah.
And I'm saving it as per a strategic asset allocation in all asset classes. I'm rebalancing very regular. Now, over and above this, I have some surplus.
Surplus.
Where, you know, even if I lose that money, I will not get sleepless nights. Okay.
Fine.
That's where they can think of these fancy things like, you know, alternate assets or, you know, doing something which is for adrenal rush or basically for entertainment. But with that thing in mind that there will be volatility, there will be, you know, risk of even losing that capital. Okay. So that money, which you are comfortable losing, you
is
know,
what you
is what you
assets.
Should put in an extremely high risk asset.
Got it.
And that too after you have ring fenced and you've planned for your goals very
and
well.
Goals and all.
Yes,
right.
Exactly. And then still if you have surplus, you can look
go
at
it.
And again, I will say that, like I said, that risk, volatility is not risk. Okay.
Yeah.
So if you have made a calculated risk, you know, you've done your due diligence on a certain asset class or in a certain investment, and you find that it's very risky, but you understand that risk. And if you give time to this, then the risk goes down, then it's okay if it's a calculated risk. But you cannot take that calculated risk on your sacred goals. If doing that is going to affect your retirement, if doing that will like actually push your retirement by 5 years, or doing that will mean a major financial setback for you, then definitely you should not look at this fancier options.
Right. So have your financial goals planned.
Exactly.
And then if you have surplus money, you can look at this alternative investments or risky assets is what we say. So yes, Nehal, I think that is it. I'm done with my questions. And if you have something new to share, you know, probably some of your interesting case studies, if you have worked on, you can just go ahead and share.
So it's like, you know, a lot of time people feel that if I select this multi-bagger stock, okay, I will create a lot of wealth.
Yeah.
Or if I select this mutual fund, you know, then I'll really be doing very good.
Yeah.
So a lot of time people spend on stock selection or security or instrument selection.
Yeah.
Whereas 85% of the success in investing or your returns are actually fixing the asset allocation.
Okay.
And not that much as chasing a multi-bagger stock or a security selection. So what investors generally do is focus too much on that security selection.
Okay.
Whereas the focus should be more on the
asset allocation.
Say if you invest very little money in a multi-bagger and if that becomes a couple of bagger, okay, but it will overall still not make a difference in your net worth. What what have you achieved? Okay.
True.
So this is one thing which I've seen with experiences that so much time, effort and energy people spend in that stock selection or in that instrument selection, whereas they have no clue of what the asset allocation is.
Yeah.
95% of money is in real estate, and on that 5%, out of that also very little will come to equity, and the whole time, effort and energy will go to find that right stock, which will be multi-bagger. Okay. Even if that 2-3% you know, for which you're putting this time, effort and energy, it becomes a couple of times
analysis,
still overall what difference is it going to make to your life,
right?
Because your 95% is still in real estate.
Realistic.
Okay. So that is one thing which I feel investors should keep in mind. And if I were to tell you case studies, we had a couple of investors who were in their early 40s when they started our journey with us. I'm saying way back 10-12 years back.
Okay.
And when they came to us and we looked at the asset allocation, about 90 to 95% was in real estate. The balance was in fixed deposit or LIC policies, and very little was in, you know, mutual funds and equity.
Yeah.
Now, in this decade, what we first advised them that enough of real estate, because you have properties where you're staying.
Yeah.
You have also built a certain real estate which is giving you rental income.
Yeah.
And so now whatever new money which is getting saved, we'll try and allocate that more to equity. Now, in this 10 years, how things have changed is that from a 90-95% real estate, they are down to about, say, 50% odd in real estate. Another, say, 35-40% in equity. Still, with this also, we've added a little bit of fixed income and a little bit of gold. So at this point of time, it's fairly balanced. Now, this approach, we had one person who was a very senior executive in a pharma company who came to us with this objective when he was, say, around 41, 42. That I don't want to end up working till 60. I would want to retire early because he was an international business head, traveling almost out of 30 days, traveling for more than 20 days.
Okay.
He was spending not much time with his spouse and his daughter. So he gave us his clear-cut goal. And then we looked at, again, the asset allocation. Now, this gentleman, we found him to be very heavy on fixed income.
Okay,
because he had EPF, plus he was investing in PPF too much in LIC. And he also had his own house. Like real estate was also fairly good. Again, he was missing investing very systematically in equity.
Yeah.
So we did this changes 10 years back.
Yeah.
And now I can very proudly say that he is 54. And he's almost like in the last 6 months where he's planning his retirement and about 6-7 years earlier.
Oh.
So once if you, you know, have clarity about the life goals, you've put the amount or the net worth you need to reach that life goals and you fixed your asset allocation, then Anil, it's very much possible for you to retire
much earlier
than what you would have thought just by fixing
the asset allocation. Right.
Yes. So like this, I'll have a lot of real life case studies where these small changes can make a significant difference, difference in like the life which the person is living.
True. Got it. So yeah, that is it, Nihal. Thank you so much for joining us with in this conversation today.
Sure. And in the closing, will just say that, you know, there are we discussed strategic asset allocation. We discussed understanding the time to the goal and all that. But at the end of the day, I would say that, you know, what gives you peace of mind? Okay, when you've made the investment, can you sleep peacefully or not? Okay, so understanding what gives you that peace of mind, that is the best asset allocation for you.
True. Thank you so much. It was a nice conversation and I'm sure it is going to be a great value for the listeners. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Anil. And, you know, all the best.
Thank you so much.
So that brings us to the end of this episode. If you want to know more on this topic, you can reach out to me on my Twitter, which is @PosteAnil, or on LinkedIn using my full name, Anil Poste. We will be happy taking your suggestions. Thank you for tuning in. See you in the next episode.
To stay updated on this podcast, follow us at HD Smartcast on all the major social media platforms. To listen to more such podcasts, log on to www.hdsmartcast.com.
Sometimes it takes a different approach to help you unlock your true potential. With Capella University's game-changing FlexPath learning format, you gain relevant skills you can apply to your career right away. Earn your degree from an accredited university and be confident in the quality of your education. Imagine your future differently at capella.edu. Capella University is accredited by the Higher Learning Commission. Learn more at capella.edu/accreditation.